Always wanted to live in the country, but never could quite get my head around the idea of actually doing it.
Yeah.
I like 24-hour things.
It's too boring.
Yeah.
I'm too quiet.
I'd like to be able to roll out and actually do something.
Yeah. See, you're from the country, so you don't have that, like, romantic vision.
No. I'm like, get me out of here. What time does the bus leave?
Driving 15 minutes for milk is not fun.
Milking the cow.
That's milking fun. The cow. Well, that's fun.
Right, Krysten?
Thanks. We had beef cows.
So do you eat meat at this point? So you're... See, because usually people have farm experience. They don't...
Maybe people that are from, like, factory farms. Maybe. I'm from a really, really gentle, awesome, tiny farm where all the cows are your pets. So it was so... humane, if you will.
Wait, so they were your pets, but you still eat them?
We didn't eat them. We would sell them. Like, you basically, like, somebody would buy a cow, and then they would have their freezer filled for the year.
Ooh, huh.
Yeah.
I guess the two of you are kind of the first birth parents of this project.
Yes? Indeed.
Yes, we are.
Who wears the pants? Wait, who?
Oh, well, last night I wore a suit, so.
Yeah, so Kat's a bottom? Wait, no.
Oh, jeez. How does it work with women?
I don't know.
Let's not think about
it. Let's not go there.
So, Fallon. This is a little threesome.
I was going to say that, actually.
Yucky.
Anyway.
Kat and I made love one day and driving around listening to sleazy hip hop music.
Getting burritos.
Yeah, getting burritos.
Well, let's go back to getting, we got some burritos, they were delicious. We had been kind of kicking around for many years since we became friends. I won't tell you how long because that would age us.
That was it, was back in 06.
Is it? Yeah.
06. Back in the day.
Back in 06.
No, it was before that we met.
Oh, it might have been 05.
Yeah, it might have been 04.
It was 04.
Well, we were in high school, right?
You're so right. It was 04.
It was 04.
That was when we both started working.
Yeah. So we've been kind of kicking around this idea of doing, like, the female swingers, a buddy comedy for girls, but we couldn't quite find the formula. It was, it's hard for women not to be kind of put into this slutty category.
Ditzy. Or, like, catch 22.
Yeah, it is. And you didn't see, you know, post-bridesmaids, it's going to be different, but pre-bridesmaids, you know, there were these movies that just didn't really work. People didn't want to go see the buddy comedy about women. So we really had this idea that we wanted to do it, but we couldn't find that formula. And then I had a baby, and we were driving around listening to sleazy hip-hop music.
Which is in the movie.
And we saw some cute guys, and they saw the baby in the back, and they squealed off, and it was a lightning strikes moment. We said, that is our story about two friends. One of them has a baby, and, you know, how do you handle life?
It was awesome. We just started writing, and we didn't really know what we were doing. We had no, like, end goal. We were just writing for the love of it and the sort of creative thing, and we had a good time doing it. So, you know, the fact that we're even here and we're talking about it is pretty ridiculous.
It's really fun, yeah. And it went through so many incarnations. I mean, there was a while where it was a studio film. There was a while where it was a sitcom.
A multi-cam sitcom with, like, somebody else, too. Every Hollywood cliche you can imagine, we went through it.
Because you guys are used to them, or because you... just reconceive what the idea was?
Well, no, because the script got out there, thank God, and, you know, people were responding to it really well. It really kind of changed the landscape for both Kat and I. We were getting, like, fancy meetings and big agents calling us, and so everyone responded to this thing about the script, but no one knew what to do with it. So they would try to make it a bigger thing, or, like, you know, she was saying, try to make it into a sitcom. No one quite knew what to do with it. So we went through this whole process, and at the end of the day, we were like, why don't we just go back to that thing that everyone liked in the beginning? And that's what we did.
And I think that process is indicative of what I think is really interesting about the movie, which is that it does address, and look, it's a fun, silly romp, you know, in a lot of ways, but it does address these kind of serious taboos, like the fact that women are supposed to be born mothers, and you don't really see the woman who has a learning curve, you know, which Krysten's character does. We've all seen Three Men and a Baby, you know, oh, the guy doesn't know how to change the diaper, isn't it funny? But a woman's not allowed to do that, and one of the obstacles we came up against when we were shopping the script around was, like, well, no one wants to see a bad mother. And we're like, she's not a bad mother, she just doesn't know how to do it yet. And you take that away, and you take away, you know, what I think is really exciting and interesting about the story, and what I think Krysten did so well in mm-hmm. portraying someone who, you
could
know,
be also could be really unlikable, because she makes absolutely. Bad decision after bad decision, even when she says, like, to her friend, like, if I would have had the last condom, this would be you. Like, yeah. Who says that? it's, you know, it could be a really unlikable character, but we didn't want to take that away. We wanted her to be a real person.
And we wanted mothers, you know, we want everyone to like the movie, but we wanted mothers to kind of look at it and go, oh, I've been that person where my, you know, my desk is a changing table and I am up all night and I don't know what to do with my career or my life or my friends. And mm-hmm. So yeah, it came from that personal place. And
so what was the attitude of all these people who were interested in the screenplay? Were they looking for something? I mean, it sounds like they were trying to turn it into 23 different things, but were they turned on by the idea of it being cute girls doing
this? You mean
this,
what did they respond
or,
to?
What do you think they were hooked into?
Well, the dialogue.
I think the dialogue was really, like, quippy and kind of, not raunchy in a really, like, disgusting way, but just kind of like, Kat and I will, like, say dirty things, but then we giggle and we're ashamed of ourselves.
That's something people don't know about girls. It's like, we really, like, it's like this secret little insight into the girl. It's like looking in, like, on a dollhouse or something, but it's the girl's world, you know?
Yeah. Well, and exactly, and it's in it. I think, again, the thing that people responded to was also the thing that made it a little scary mm-hmm. to bring to life, because you don't have the prototypes for, you know, everyone knows about the male buddy comedy, guys talking about girls being bad, you know? Mm-hmm. And in our film, it's like women living in a house with beer bottles and pizza boxes strewn everywhere and kind of, you know, talking about small cocks and the disease, you know, and stuff like that. And it is, there's no prototype for it. So, you know, I don't want to say that we're, like, ridiculously groundbreaking, but there is a level, you know, of kind of like, oh, we're not used to seeing girls do that. And so it became hard to place. And so I really think it is, you know, what was appealing about the movie was also scary to people.
You know what it's like? For girls or for me to watch the movie, it's like when you've had a big dinner and you kind of unzip your pants secretly. It's like that relief. It's like, oh, okay, someone's talking about it.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, that's cute.
That is
cute. Well, it's an interesting phenomenon, because the idea of how objectified women are in general in this business versus the idea of kind of empowerment of actually telling the truth, or like a question of how commercial that is or how viable that is, I don't think that's really even changed with Bridesmaid. I mean, ultimately, nobody actually shat in the sink in this movie. You know, and that's what everybody kind of takes away somehow from that movie, this very broad, this is a much more kind of to the
this is much
point
smaller.
Comedy.
Yeah. You know,
much
more
smaller,
intimate.
Yeah.
And much more
and
real and
intimate. Smaller in budget, too. We can't really be compared to Bridesmaids. It's just not fair.
I know. Even when we've been compared, you know, unfavorably to Bridesmaids, I'm like, yes, that's amazing. You know, but what I think it shares is Bridesmaids, really, to me, what I take away from it, I try to ignore the poop in the sink, you know, what I take away from it is women having a relationship together that is explored, mm-hmm. and you don't see that. Women often in movies, and in movies that I love, like Knocked Up, they're the foils for the comedy. They're not the comedy. Mm-hmm. And especially in this movie, you know, such beautiful women. I mean, Krysten and Fallon and Kate and Rachel. Like, pretty women can be funny, too. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think that these are things that are kind of fun. And I think people are going to watch the movie and be like, oh, cool. You know, it's nice to see that. Yeah.
And going back to the objectifying thing, we objectified men quite a bit in this movie, and I really enjoyed that behind the scenes. Justin Kirk, we made him
one
have
of our
a mustache.
Goals.
Yeah, this movie is girly, and not girly in like the way people's brain usually goes through, like silly and pink and stupid. It was girly because the girls come first, and the boys mm-hmm. are on the, like, totally secondary. But we made Justin Kirk have a mustache. Jeff Stultz, I was like, great. He was like, Krysten, I love you. I'll do anything for you. I'm like, great. Will you, can I frost your hair? He was like, what? I made him lighten his hair for the
we
movie.
Made two men.
I made him work out.
Frost their hair in this film. Because Reese Coiro, my husband, and Jeff Stultz both frosted their hair.
I thought Jeff just, that's what his hair was doing at the moment. I didn't know that.
He's a little bit, he's got like brown hair.
Yeah, he's like a little red or something.
I thought that he would look really sexy as blonde, and I was right.
Can you imagine the male director with his two male co-stars being like, yeah, and then I made her dye her hair and work out?
Hey, it happens.
And yet they do
everyone.
On every movie. Yeah.
Every movie, every girl I know has to get a trainer, has to do this. True. So this is like, we got to turn everything on its head.
But I'm just imagining them sitting there talking about it as openly as we are.
Right.
That's where I like the, you know, you're kind of allowed to, as a girl, be like, yeah, we objectified those men.
And it was awesome. Yeah, Jeff was in the gym like four hours a day.
So did you do it for sport, or was it because they really, the character needed it?
Oh, no, both.
He had to be eye candy, and he's so wonderful and charming, and his performance is great in the movie. But it was, you know, their instant connection has to be justified, you know, and she's kind of in this very desperate state in the film. You know, she hasn't had sex since she got pregnant, and so she is on the prowl. And so we needed a guy who would just be like, bam, must have him.
Must have him. He's perfect on paper. He's like this bright, shiny thing. So we just wanted him to look as hot as possible, which really isn't that hard because Jeff is one of those freaks of nature.
You know what I also like? Justin Kirk and Kate's relationship. It's like sometimes guys don't know that they can lay it on if they really are real about it and they're really determined and it comes from a true place. Like laying it on thick can be a good thing sometimes.
Yeah.
And being truthful and saying how much you like a girl, I mean, it doesn't always work, but...
Go for it.
Yeah, go for it.
And having that, I mean, one thing about Justin Kirk in the film is he has this very strange confidence.
Yeah.
And it, you know, that role was so hard to cast. And when we kind of hit upon Justin Kirk, we were like, he has that thing where it's like, why are you so confident? But my God, you are so confident and it's so attractive. And what secret do you have going on, you know, that makes you this confident? And it is, it's interesting, like, that he can kind of bag the Kate Bosworth, you know, through just persistence.
Yeah, I love that. I know, I love when I get hit on at the grocery store. I'm always like, good for you.
Yeah.
I can't go
out
with
every guy wants to hear. Good for you.
Go for it, man. Yeah. It's always the weirdest people that have the balls to do it.
Yeah. Yeah. And you never know.
It's never like the hot ones that you want to go out with. They're always like in the corner being stupid.
Well, you live in Los Angeles, they're all gay, right? All those guys are in the corner. I don't know.
Oh,
we're taken.
Oh.
The Whole Foods.
We all have boyfriends anyway.
So, how was the writing experience for the two of you? Was it formal? Was it relaxed? Did you share pages? Did you sit in a room together?
By formal, do you mean sitting together drinking a bottle of wine? No, look, we've been friends for a long time, like we said, and we worked on the script in many different ways. You know, sometimes in the room together, sometimes shooting stuff back and forth. My favorite story is, you know, my daughter, my first child, was 3 months old, and I call Krysten, like, I'm not going to get the pages back to you because this is so hard. Nobody knows how hard this is. And the next day, she sends me the script with my voicemail transcribed exactly. And I was like,
she's like, oh, yeah.
Thanks, Krysten. But it really, you know, it was a very organic process, and it was very fun. And, you know, we always say, looking back on the movie, it's not like, oh, Krysten wrote that, Kat wrote that, Krysten wrote that. It really is a true collaboration.
Yeah.
It's like really making fun. A baby, sorry.
Like making a baby.
Thank you for that.
I love writing with somebody else. It's really fun. You never get stuck. And if you do, like, huh, what should I do next? Like, there's always somewhere to go. It's so much faster. Two heads are better than one. I really enjoy the collaborative process.
Have you had other collaborations with directors that work?
Yeah, and I've written things with another girl. Kat and I have 3 scripts that are in various stages. Like, I always collaborate with friends. So you, it's like the best.
Yeah, you know, I've written alone and I've written with friends, and I think especially writing with actors. You know, actors bring something very special to characters where it's like, no, I would never say that. Or, you know, this dialogue feels very clunky. And so I especially love working with actors. And, you know, our experience has definitely been pretty amazing.
Yeah, totally positive.
So fun. When did you decide you were a director, Kat?
You know, I've been directing shorts for many years.
When you were in school? Or, I mean, you're pretty young still.
Yeah, I studied theater directing in school, and then I went through many, 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 many different kind of phases in the industry, let's just say, you know, behind camera, on camera, did a lot of things, started doing shorts, and, you know, they just kind of got progressively bigger and bigger, started off with a video camera, me and my dog, you know, and ended with feature films.
Was it because you really wanted to direct, or because you weren't finding what you were liked as an actress, or...
No, I don't want to act ever. Absolutely not. No, you know, it's a very hard, it is, you know, undoubtedly a very hard thing to get into. You have to generate your own material to start because, you know, I'm sure it happens, but it's very rare for people to give a lot of money to somebody to make something unless they've kind of proven themselves. You know, so for me, it was like I did these small little shorts, and then I got a grant from Panavision where I made my first short on film, and I was able to kind of show that and get the trust of actors. And then I started doing stuff for Funny or Die, and I did actually one little Funny or Die with Kate Bosworth, Zoe Saldana, and Janine Garofalo that went viral. And from
I still get emails from Funny or Die about that. Like,
oh, nice.
You're still promoting it.
Great.
A year later, 2 years later.
Oh, yeah, it's getting up there in the millions. But that was where I first worked with Kate Bosworth. And, you know, so then we had this script and we kind of talked about it and we're like, oh, Kate would be perfect. And, you know, she's not kind of known as a comedic actress, but she was so funny when I worked with her on the Funny or Die sketch. And so we sent her the script and she signed on and, you know, we kind of assembled our whole cast. And so that was the process for me. It really is about, you know, getting your talent, getting the actors that you want to kind of say, yes, I like this material. And that's how stuff gets made. So it was many, many years of making shorts till I got to that point where I could show people my work and say, look, I know what I'm doing.
So has Funny or Die kind of become the incubator, do you think, for a lot of up and coming directors?
You know, I don't know. I think there's so many different paths. I couldn't speak to that. But I think it's wonderful. It's like a little short studio. That's kind of how I look at it, because they give you money, they let you do your thing.
And so how did you cast the movie? Krysten was hard to get, I guess.
Yeah, I couldn't get her on the phone.
We just called up our friends, really. I mean, she was friends with Kate, I was friends with Jeff and Rachel and Justin Kirk and Krysten Johnson. I was working with at the time on another movie when we found the financing. So I'm like, hey guys, would you do this? And she was friends with Jason Biggs. Like, literally, we just...
And his wife, Jenny Mullen, who plays the little receptionist.
And their dog.
Yeah, and then, like, the babies, you know, belong to friends of ours. We found Fallon. Fallon and Andrea Savage were the two people we kind of didn't know who we found for the movie. And, you know, I mean, I look at this film and I'm just so happy with the casting, you know. And, I mean, we'd be biting our nails every day, like, is someone going to drop out?
Yeah, and we got so lucky getting for $0, you know. We're like, please just come out, we'll be your best friend.
Yeah, the hardest person to get on the movie was my husband.
I know.
He was like the last one we cast. I was like, please, you'll be so good. But yeah, it's definitely, there is a kind of friends and family aspect to it. And I think that reads in the film, too, you know.
How long did you shoot?
17 days.
17 days. Baby. 17. It does seem like the magical 17. No, I didn't say 70.
Oh, we thought you said 70. No.
Yes, I was waiting for the CG as well.
There would have been a lot less one shots. I'll put that out there.
No, it's fascinating because Sundance this year was like all 17 to 21 days. Almost none of the movies, no matter how big or small they were, at the festival, were all 17 to 21 days.
Yeah. It's pretty cool. It's frustrating because it's either like a micro budget or $100 million budget. There's no like middle class movies anymore. So that's you know. Not great for people making a living, but it seems like people are just getting in there and you can make great stories and not have all the big tricks. I mean, I think that's the coolest thing. Like, you're, I'm seeing, like, I was watching, like, I think you told me to watch The Freebie, Asshole movie. Like that, I just watched The Pill. That one was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Like, these $40,000 movies, if you have a good story, you don't need anything else.
Well, Kate did Katie Asselton's next movie. That was at Sundance this year, Black Rock.
Yeah, I didn't see it.
Which is also kind of a departure from what you would expect. It's kind of, it starts as three pretty girls going on a vacation and then they all have to fight for their lives for the rest of the movie.
Oh, is it a horror film?
Kate's in it.
It's a kind of a thriller. Kate's in it, yeah. Kate's one of the three of them. And it's a thriller. It turns into this intense thriller. A guy comes back from Iraq, is insane, and they start hunting them on this island. They all have to become commandos. And
I mean, there is something. It is hard as a filmmaker to make a movie in 17 days because you don't have many takes. I mean, the average takes on this movie was 3, and it was kind of like, did we get what we needed for the story? Okay, we're moving on.
Hit it or quit it.
Yeah, you know, and there's really no. You know, what's hard, especially in a comedy, is there's no room for improv. It's like we had to get that script exactly as it is and then move on. But I do think you're right, there's an immediacy to it and kind of an energy to it. And it does come from a pure place. Yeah. Like, we were all there just telling this story that we wanted to tell. And there wasn't much room for anything other than that.
So was it strange moving into somebody else's family film?
No, I liked it.
She's one of the family.
Yeah,
we brought her in. No, absolutely. It's really fun, I think, you know, kind of having that dynamic and then bringing, you know, the people that we didn't know into it. And, you know, it was Fallon and Andrea, but there were others too.
At the end of the day, like, everyone was there with a common goal and everyone was there committed to do this thing. It didn't really matter where everyone was coming from. You know what I mean?
And you were strict about the script, it sounds like what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fairly
unusual. Had to be. We didn't have a choice. But we rehearsed a lot ahead of time. I like to rehearse. Mm-hmm. It's good. You sort of work out any kinks. You don't have time to get to set and run into problems.
No. And that's how you know, a movie like this works, is with intense planning and storyboarding and shot listing. You know, and I know other people do it differently. Katie Asselton does it differently. It's a lot of improv. Mm-hmm. But for me, you know, to feel comfortable stepping onto a set, I have to know exactly how it's all laid out. And, you know, our actors were just brilliant and prepared, and so it worked out, I think.
So what was the hardest thing about it?
The time. The time.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, you know,
We were all like 10 pounds lighter and bags in our eyes by the end, because we were just like going. I was cheating my sign out time so I could stay on set longer.
They don't cut this.
So, you know, like, what, doing whatever it takes,
true,
really.
It's not true.
There is no SAG anymore. Don't worry.
Yeah, I mean, look, I look at the movie and I love it, and for what we had, I wouldn't change anything. There are definitely shots where I'm like, man, some coverage would have been nice, but you don't have time for coverage, so you have to make it work, and that's, you know, a testament to the actors, too, being able to sit there in one shot and play out a whole scene. I mean, that kitchen scene, I was watching it last night, and I'm like, I cannot believe.
We love any coverage.
That there's no, but there, you know, you wouldn't make the day, so...
But there's something interesting always about having to cut around or figuring that out. You know, it's almost like that's part of the palette as an artist.
Absolutely.
You
have to,
like... Yeah, it's fun. Those limitations, I think, sort of help. You know, it's fun to see what you can do inside of these limitations.
Mm. Creativity, I think, flourishes inside constraint.
Yes, for sure. Agree.
Point. And you've already done another movie since then? Since this?
I've done two features since this. The second one is premiering at the Tribeca Film Festival on April 21st in the narrative competition.
So you've done two features since this and had a baby.
Yeah.
You're a busy woman.
She doesn't even need to sleep. She's crazy. She's like the most like hardworking, psychotic woman ever. It's
well,
amazing.
Maybe the second.
Second, yeah, fine. We're both psychotic.
Third, I don't know. No, I mean, I think that's part of kind of... You know, the dynamic, we love to kind of surround ourselves with badasses, you know, who just don't stop working. And I mean, you know, Krysten's always been an inspiration for me. And people are like, how do you do it? And I'm like, well, I lived with Krysten Ritter and I watched her. And, you know, you really, you can't stop working in this business. Ain't it true?
Yeah, you can't. Mm-hmm. It's really a 24-hour thing. And if you don't do it, somebody else will.
Yeah.
I just don't know how Kat does it with two kids. I just don't.
I just bring them everywhere.
Yeah.
So did you get to town and just know that instinctively? Was it who you were when you got here?
Yeah, I figured it out pretty young.
And was it a hard transition, or did you find it just worked your way into everything?
I don't think I ever had a fear of rejection, and or I wasn't afraid. I don't know. I just was like, I'm gonna do this. I started out as a model, and I really wasn't happy. And then I like found acting and writing, and I was like, I want to do this, and I have full control because I can always work harder and be better. Mm-hmm. And so that was it. And I just was like, I don't want to go home to the farm.
And where's the farm?
The farm is in Shikshinee, Pennsylvania, which is lovely. I just don't want to go back to the farm.
Do you go back just to visit?
Yeah, to visit, of course, but I'm not stuck.
You're allowed to leave.
It's all about freedom. It's always been really important to me to have financial independence and have freedom. Mm-hmm. I knew if I ever, like, for example, ran out of money, I'd be dead on the side of the road and there would be nobody to help me.
I would be there.
Thanks.
That's so sad.
That was like what really drove me in the beginning. Now I chill out a little bit.
Yeah. It's also about putting your mark down and kind of, you know, saying what you want to say, and so that people start coming to you instead of you coming to people and being like, please, can I have a job? You know, when you start putting your voice out there, people are like, oh, that's interesting. I want to be a part of that.
And it's what you're saying, like, about we work really hard on your short films, and then finally people trust you. If you work really, really hard, you get to a point where you can delegate more, and you can kind of relax and have like things working for you, and you have to do less. Eventually, I think the goal is to do as little work as possible. Eventually.
Well, and get paid the most.
Get the machine running.
Look,
and then...
It is such a collaborative art form. And you know, how I have a movie right now that I'm editing, you know, but I have the most wonderful editor who I trust with my life, and so I can kind of come and do something like this and go, I know you're going to be doing what I need you to be doing on the film right now.
And you have him, meanwhile you have him on Skype, like, watching him.
Oh yeah, he's, yeah, I do.
It's all about trust. It's like that game when someone, you catch someone, you're supposed to catch them, and they're supposed to, like, know you're going to catch them, but you're not really sure if they're going to catch you. You know, that's like what this business is about. Like, you, yeah, you all have to kind of stand behind each other and catch. Yeah. Hopefully.
And surround yourself with the good people, you know. And I mean, I know I do it, and you do it, and now you're part of the family. You do it, you know. It's like you find those people you stick to, and you know they're going to do the work. You know they're going to do a good job, and that's who you work with again and again and again.
And you're not from a farm.
I'm not.
Where are you from, actually?
Well, I was born in Manhattan, and I lived many different places. Traveled all around. Went to boarding school in Michigan, and then college in Pittsburgh, and Russia, and then moved back to New York, and now I'm in L.A., and I
love
L.A.
So it's warm here compared to every place else you've been.
You know, lived in the Caribbean for a little while, so.
Miami.
Miami, yeah.
And Fallon, what brought you out here?
I'm from Louisiana, so I also kind of came from the country, I guess. A little swamp.
The land of tax breaks.
Yeah.
This is true.
New Hollywood.
I just, I set my parents down. I remember it was one Christmas, and I told them that I was going to move to L.A. They actually thought I was telling them that I was pregnant or something, because they were like, I was like, you guys need to sit down, I need to tell you something serious. I want to be an actress, and I'm going to go to L.A., and they kind of laughed at me for a couple months. And I actually ended up going online and finding this agent on, like, Google. I Googled it, and I was paying her, like, $3.99 a question to ask her about what to do, and I met her out here, made my parents meet her, we all got in a hotel room, she maybe did a little monologue, and she was like, she can act. And this woman convinced my parents that I could move out to LA and act. I mean, since then, God bless her for that, but.
That's so awesome. That's so crazy.
I don't know if it would work out the same way for everybody. I don't know if we should advise people to go Googling agents.
Don't Google and pay $3.99 for acting questions.
Have you ever asked her a question since?
No. Wow, that seems like a good little racket.
It's
I know. Should we?
Story.
We should start a whole company, guys.
$20 per question.
We'll give you advice. We'll read your scripts.
So, was there a moment when you realized that she was a kind of a scam, and you had to go into the real business?
Yeah, there were some moments where I was like, there were payments involved for her.
Oh my God!
Sending me to like headshot places and meeting people. It was like I had my own actor's concierge, so that it wasn't really a concierge or working.
But it's cool.
You need that.
And it's like, it just takes that thing to get you doing what you want to do. And some, you know, it's maybe not the right path.
Yeah.
And that's what I think is so interesting about this business. There is no path. There's no, you know, people say, what advice do you give?
There's no formula.
Besides work.
Yeah, work hard. That's the only advice.
But look at that. I mean, that's amazing to kind of like find someone online and then be here, you know, doing what you love.
She's a great con artist. She really convinced my parents, and that's
all that matters. Good for her.
This is a town full of them. And there's some of them running some of the film schools, so it's a little scary out there. You got to be careful who you're giving your money to. So this movie is coming out. Do you guys have like a sense of what it needs to be or do, or what the response needs to be to feel like you're fulfilled by it? Or
we're totally fulfilled.
We're already done. No,
this
honestly,
is insane that we're even, literally the fact that we're even talking about this movie is sort of beyond.
It's a tiny little movie. And
some of the shots are at our houses.
Oh, I mean,
they're all of dogs.
Them, all the restaurants in the film are one restaurant that a friend of mine owns that we kind of like sectioned off. We're like, this is one restaurant, this is second restaurant. I mean, it really is a small film. And so, you know, to have it be seen by audiences, that's kind of all that we ever hoped for. And so the fact that it's getting a theatrical release and it's, you know, Universal is distributing it on demand this summer, it's a dream come true.
I got one. There are no small films, just small budgets.
Yes.
Like that actor phrase, you know, never mind.
But what is that?
No small parts, only small, whatever.
Yeah, something like that.
Something.
Is that generally the rule for you guys, that you kind of, you've done the work,
and
that's what is the thing that turned you on?
You can't have expectations. You really can't. I think as long as you do the work and you're happy with what you did, you can sleep at night. The rest is like bullshit.
And Krysten just won the acting award of excellence at the Vail Film Festival last weekend for this film. And you said when you were on the stage, you know, you were saying that it, it you you are entertained by the movie.
Yeah.
And that's all that matters. And I feel that way to a certain extent. Do we want people to love it? Absolutely. Do we want it to entertain the country and have a huge, you know, theatrical release? And yes. But the fact is, we all sit and watch the movie and like it. And if we can accomplish that, I think we're good. What do you always cry?
I always cry. I mean, every time I watch the movie, I'm thoroughly entertained. I laugh. I was laughing pretty loud last night. No, I was really like kind of laughed.
Oh, that was you.
Yeah. I think I heard that.
No, but you know, if you can make someone cry repeatedly, you've done your job. That's what I would say.
Sure.